It was, I was numb.
This video is about speaking tips and answering interview questions using Prince Harry's examples. It's a mix of stiff, clumsy, awkward, but also clever and brilliant answers from Harry that I've gathered from watching hours and hours of videos of him. And if you have interviews in the media or podcast or panel discussions or even a job interview, you can use these examples as a guide. If you're new here, I'm Rachel Smets, TEDx and speaker coach, and creating videos on communication skills using famous personalities as examples.
Call me whatever you want at this point. Yeah, Harry, Haz, Baz, Bazza, Spike, Bazzaroonie, it's all there.
I did expect Harry to show a lot more confidence, considering the amount of practice that he has. But oddly enough, I found a lot of signs of nervousness that you definitely want to avoid. Pay attention to this clip here, where he's rubbing his hands. Or here, this is an old video, it's 2015, but he's holding one hand on the rail, the other hand in his pocket. He clearly doesn't really know what to do with his hands. It's like this uncertainty, this tension, this nervousness. He just doesn't know how to behave, but it certainly doesn't look very comfortable. Another clear sign of nervousness is these lips that are pursing. Lips pursing is a sign of tension, and sometimes it's very subtle, and sometimes he shows it a bit longer, but showing that is a clear sign of clenching the jaws and tension, nervousness, uncertainty. And then here, blowing out a sigh of relief, like, oh, I'm done, it's over with. It's clearly no enthusiasm at all. He didn't like it one bit. And yes, it's an older video, but it's just one of these signs that you want to avoid to show the whole mass media that you didn't like it and you just wanted to get it over with. If you're sitting down in an interview, which you probably are, then take a look at these weird behaviors. Look at Harry, how he's moving around, he's rubbing his hands on his knees. He seems stiff and distracted. And then look at the interviewer on the other hand, how relaxed she's sitting. They're both in the exact same chair. You could think one chair is more uncomfortable than the other, but no, it's the exact same chair. And then look at the interviewer who's sitting back, very comfortable, very confident appearance, and crossing her legs and not moving at all. Very relaxed. Compare this to Harry sitting in the exact same chair, wiggling around, really this tension, this stiffness, this nervousness, the uncertainty or stress, but definitely not comfortable. Of course, Harry also shows more confident appearances, like his entrance here in the late night show. And by the way, if you like this so far, can you please hit the like button and a subscribe? Thank you so much. The way he walks here, he sits down, he greets everyone, he waves, he's very comfortable, very relaxed. Having said that, I have to mention one gesture, one typical gesture that I found Harry doing in all his entrances, walking outside, inside, everywhere, pretty much. You'll notice that he's holding one hand, almost like he's closing the button of his jacket. He's holding one hand always in front of him, and that's a sign of self-protection. Yes, he's a prince, he's a royal figure, he wants to protect, it's his duty, but it's like a sign of self-protection, like, I don't want to open up too much, I want to protect myself. It's like a self-defense mechanism, sort of. You'll also notice how Prince Harry uses a lot of hand gestures, arms go up and down, and he's very expressive with his body language, which is totally fine. But compared to other clips, you notice how here his gestures are comfortable and relaxed and open, compared to the other ones where it was more stiff and more rigid. The fear of public speaking is something that Harry seriously struggled with, and he reveals that in his book. He even refers to it as having panic attacks. I'm just going to read a few lines from his book where he says, "My official life was all about being in public, standing up in front of people, giving speeches and talks, doing interviews, and now I found myself nearly incapable of fulfilling these basic functions. Hours before a speech, I'd be soaked in sweat. Then, during the event itself, unable to think, mind buzzing with fear and fantasies of running away." Oh my gosh. And then he says, "The panic often started with putting on a suit first thing in the morning. And then he goes on that it wasn't merely about public appearances, but also public venues and all of the crowds. I came to fear simply being around other human beings. I came to fear simply being around other human beings. That's how far his fear went. He really struggled. And I think this is so beautiful that he shares that. It's so good to know, because sometimes we see these speakers, and I sure was one of them, that I was looking at other people thinking, wow, they're born with confidence. They speak so naturally, it just comes natural to them, but it's not true. And then I started analyzing, and I published a book about confidence, a course about confidence, because I really wanted to know, what is it? Is it possible to learn? And yes, confidence is like a muscle that grows. And now when I see other celebrities or famous people, I know for sure they're not born with it. They have to learn it. They have to practice it. They have to overcome it. And there are different hacks that you can try, you know, like simple things, surrounding yourself with other confident people, taking small steps out of your comfort zone. Your mindset matters as well. And saying no to energy vampires. But these are just a few of the tiny hacks that I can mention here, or I'll make another video about it. But I like that Prince Harry, such a public figure, literally had, well, I don't like it for him. I don't want anybody to have panic attacks, but it just goes to show that fear is very, very common. And if that's you, please keep practicing, keep looking at these examples of what to do, try it out, what to avoid, and just try to improve yourself moment after moment. And that's exactly what I'm doing. Even in these videos, I'm trying to improve myself all of the time. A great and simple way to make your answers in interviews more captivating, more engaging, is to make them relatable. And Prince Harry does this very well.
We as human beings are compassionate people, mm-hmm. but when your life becomes really hard, mm-hmm. it can be, for some, harder to find the compassion for other people.
We as human beings are compassionate beings. So here you see he's shifting from I, me, my, to we. He's generalizing. And by doing that, he's talking to you. He's talking to the audience. And if you, in any answers that you give, can switch from I and my story to also make it relatable to them, to your audience, that captivates and connects. It makes it more likable as well.
Right? It's a responsibility that I feel as a parent, that you probably feel as a parent as well. And it's,
I feel responsible as a parent, and you probably do it too. So again, it goes from I to you. It's a constant switch from I to you. And that's the kind of game you want to play, if you want to call it a game, in your content, to constantly refer to you, the audience. And that makes it relatable and makes you likable.
I think anyone who suffers from trauma, shock, grief, loss, which we all have and all will, that you have got to put on a brave face.
He mentions grief and adds, as we all have. Again, he's generalizing, he's talking to the audience, and yeah, everybody has suffered some type of grief, so we can relate to that. And that's the connection that's created here. The trick really is to answer in a way that engages, that people can relate to, that people understand. You know, things like being a parent, having grief, anything that people know in their own lives, they can relate to, that creates the connection, and that increases the likability as well.
That whatever experiences you, negative experiences that you had, that you can make it right for your kids.
Another really, really easy technique when you're answering questions is very simply smile. When you smile and talk, it makes such a difference on how you come across. And a genuine smile is called a Duchenne smile. A Duchenne smile is one where the corner of your lips, of your mouth, go up, and you see the crow's feet here as well. So you could smile with no expression here and just, you know, smile and just curl your lips. But if you smile genuinely, then your whole face lights up. And that's what he does here. You can tell the difference. Sometimes a smile is genuine and sometimes it's not. Pay attention when people are smiling. You'll notice a difference. Something that's way more challenging to achieve and Prince Harry has not yet unlearned is this. The Ums, Ahs, you know, all of these filler words. The filler words to fill up gaps. We don't want silences. We want to avoid silences. At least we think we do. But the power is in pausing. If you have a pause, if you need a moment to think about your answer, then have the silence. There are some people who do this very often, maybe a little bit too long sometimes. I have a video where I show a very long 13-second silence of Elon Musk, and I'll link to that below. But another person that does this so well is Cyllian Murphy, and I've made a video about him as well, and show you a lot of examples where he has this silent strength. You don't have to be silent too much. You don't have to pause too long. But more silence gives more confidence, more charisma. Even though we think, oh no, I have to answer right away and I have to immediately come up with something. But what happens if we don't allow time to think, then we fill it up with, and that's not it. So it's better to just wait. And then think about your answer, and then answer.
Why? It wasn't through lack of trying.
You can see he's taking a moment to think, and then he speaks. Another moment of uncertainty and doubt is when Harry stumbles over his words. And this is a great example of it.
And, you know, home for me now is you know, for the time being, it's in the States. And it feels that way as well.
Does it?
Yeah. We've been welcomed with open arms.
Yeah.
And it's got such a great community up in Santa Barbara. So
the only short answer that he's attempting to say is that home for me is the States. But the way he says it, he's looking side to side, he's shrugging his shoulders, he's repeating certain words, and it's like home. Is, and then it's repeating words, and it's so uncomfortable. It's like he wants to say something, but he's scared. It's uncertain. There's so much nervousness and tension in the way he says this very simple sentence. When you see someone shrugging shoulders, maybe one side, maybe both sides, it's always a sign of lack. A lack of knowledge, a lack of power, a lack of authority, a lack of answer, a lack of confidence, a lack of I don't really care, a lack of interest. And so whatever is going on here, he's clearly nervous, uncertain. There's no confidence whatsoever in the way he answers this. And then again, sometimes it's best to just say what you think, because that is authentic and that is genuine. So let's take a look at these examples.
What's on the shortlist?
There's a few things on the shortlist, but I don't want to speculate because I know what people are like. But as long as they know that they can trust me in making the right decision.
This is an interview back in 2012. He's honest, he's authentic.
Is there part of you that would like that normal life?
I'd never want to be stuck behind a computer desk in the city, if that's the question. I don't know where you heard that from. I must have said something I shouldn't have done. You know, the normal for me, I don't know what normal is anymore. I never really have done, but
I don't know what normal is. That's an authentic answer. Let's look at something very powerful, and that is being vulnerable. Here he talks about coping with the death of his mom.
There was nothing there. I was numb.
Did you feel guilty for not crying?
Once I started therapy, I started to understand that, or at least I thought, that there was this huge weight on my chest due to the fact that I hadn't cried and that my mum needed me to cry, or I needed to cry to prove to my mum that I missed her. I suddenly realized that actually she didn't want me to cry. She really just wanted me to be happy.
He didn't cry. He was numb. He did therapy as well. He's revealing all of these moments that are so personal and so vulnerable. And that's a great tactic. If you can show vulnerability, people connect to that. People feel you. And that grabbing that emotion is very captivating. Being vulnerable is a sign of courage, not a sign of weakness. And when you share struggles and challenges, people connect with that. And one person who's really good in doing that is Gary Vee. And I made a video about that I'll link below. If you can add more struggles, problems, failures, people connect with that very well.
But I will focus on my life, my amazing family that I'm so grateful to have, my two kids who are bouncing up and down me this morning.
I'm not angry anymore.
What he just says here is a great connecting hack. It's that mini storytelling technique that if you can add that in an answer, people connect to that. He's talking about how grateful he is for his family, his two kids, jumping up and down. And literally that tiny story creates an image in our minds. We can see the kids jumping up and down. We can see him smiling. And that connects, that engages. And if you can do that, you don't have to share a whole bunch of personal stuff, but just that little mini story makes a huge difference. If you want a lot more examples on storytelling in subtle ways or sharing challenges and struggles and failures without revealing your entire life, then watch this next video. You'll find a ton of examples that you can use in your next interviews, stories, speeches, talks, meetings, and have fun with it. I'll see you there.